prayers fall on deaf ears.
Like Job, we begin looking for you to the east, to the west, to the north, and the south.
The four points of the horizon and the compass, but you are nowhere to be found.
The darkness threatens to swallow us whole, and we feel as though we are drowning in an ocean of divine silence.
Lord, then we are tempted to do something cheap or dirty,
or something that will bring great shame upon us and those we love.
Have mercy on us, O God. Hear the word of the Lord from Job 42, verse 12. The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the first. Our God turns crucifixions into resurrections. What was dead is now alive, and what was once defeat is now an everlasting triumph. Christ is alive. He forgives you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I know that my Redeemer lives. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And let us pray. Merciful Father, empower us to believe that when you have tested us, we will come forth as gold. For you work all things together for our good and your everlasting glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Now I invite the children who are watching to come closer to the screens that you are viewing the service from, and we're going to have a special moment together to talk about God's Word. Also, as we are talking about God's Word today, as I said in the introduction, there is a children's bulletin for you. And for the children's talk today, we're going to look at the appointed gospel lesson where Jesus has to deal with the death of his friend Lazarus. Now, when you think about someone dying, it's pretty deflating, isn't it? Yesterday, I went out into the garage and I was looking for something that I could inflate, and this was pretty much deflated. And this is a floaty you would use for a pool, isn't it? You need a floaty in a pool, otherwise you can't stay above the water, and you can be very scared about being in the water without a flotation device, something to keep you above water. So with this flotation device, would this one be very good or very effective the way it is right now? No. If your parents would tell you, don't get into this floaty right now because it's not going to do you a whole lot of good. So what do we need to do? We need to bring life back into the flotation device. So what you can do is take a pump and you can add air. And you can add air and you can add air until it fully inflates. Now with the pump that I have, this manual pump, this would take a long time. We're not going to spend all morning doing this. But we know that after a while, it will be fully inflated and it could work. And it will work to keep you above water. It will keep you safe. It will save your life. So today in our gospel lesson, when Jesus is dealing with the death of his friend Lazarus, he is sad. Just as all of us are sad when we lose a loved one. What can happen when someone dies? Is there anything good that can occur? Well, Jesus comes to where Lazarus has been laid dead, and he makes an amazing and important announcement. He says to the crowds, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even though he dies, yet shall he live again. Think about that promise, boys and girls. Even though we deal with someone who dies, their body is no more. Jesus says, I will bring life into that body. And that's exactly what he showed to the crowds. Because what did he do? He called Lazarus, who was dead in the tomb. He called to Lazarus, who was dead in the tomb, and you know what happened? Lazarus came back alive. He came back alive and he showed himself alive to the crowds. And people were amazed. It's a pretty amazing celebration, isn't it? For Lazarus, who is dead, who is now alive. The same is true for you and me through Jesus. We are dead in our sins. You know those things that we do wrong? Sometimes we don't listen to our parents, and sometimes we're not nice to our brothers and sisters. But through Jesus, we can say, we're sorry. Bring us back to life again. And that's what Jesus does for us. It reinflates us through his forgiveness. And we are given life again. And not only do we have life through his forgiveness now, but he does promise us that even though we die, we will live forever. And I want you to hold on to that promise, because you're going to know somebody who dies. But those who die in Jesus will live forever. And so will you, and so will I. We want to know Jesus and to live in him forever. So let's say a prayer. You can say these words after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for being my Savior. Help me to know that you are my life and my salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's children say, amen. Well, again, check out your children's bulletin today, and you can learn more about Lazarus and Jesus' amazing victory, giving him life once again. And now our Old Testament reading from Job chapter 23. Then Job answered and said, today also my complaint is bitter. My hand is heavy on account of my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come even to his seat. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would know what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, he would pay attention to me. There an upright man could argue with him, and I would be acquitted forever by my judge. Behold, I go forward, but he is not there, and backward, but I do not perceive him. On the left hand, where he is working, I do not behold him. He turns to the right hand, but I do not see him. But he knows the way that I take. When he has tried me, I shall come out as gold. My foot has held fast to his steps. I have kept his way and have not turned aside. I have not departed from the commandment of his lips. I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my portion for food. But he is unchangeable, and who can turn him back? What he desires, that he does. For he will complete what he appoints for me, and many such things are on his mind. Therefore, I am terrified at his presence. When I consider, I am in dread of him. God has made my heart faint. The Almighty has terrified me. Yet I am not silenced because of the darkness, nor because thick darkness covers my face. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5. The love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. Now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you, on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now great crowds accompanied Jesus, and he turned and said to them, If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and comes after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, desiring to build a tower, does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation, is not able to finish. All who see it began to mock him, saying, This man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king, going out to encounter another king in war, will not sit down first and deliberate whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? And if not, while the other is yet a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We make confession of our Christian faith this morning. We use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now we continue with our next hymn, Go to Dark Gethsemane.
Thank you.
grace, mercy, and peace be yours from God, our Heavenly Father, and from Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Today, as we continue our journey in the book of Job, we're going to focus on these words from Job chapter 23. Job's response to his so-called friend Eliphaz, who has convinced him, or tried to convince him, that the reason for his suffering is because of his sin. Yet Job knows otherwise. He has not sinned to deserve what he has been facing, and he still seeks an audience with God. Verses 8 through 11. Behold, I go forward, but he is not there, and backward, I do not perceive him. On the left hand, when he is working, I do not behold him. He turns to the right hand, but I do not see him. But he knows the way that I take. When he has tried me, I shall come out as gold. My foot has held fast to his steps. I have kept his way and have not turned aside. Yes, Job continues to struggle. You and I continue to struggle with this COVID-19, the situation, like Job, that never seems to go away. The pain, the difficulty, the unknown. And so, like Job, we seek an audience with God, and that's what we have today. Every time we come to God's Word, we seek His face. God does not hide His face from us, but He communicates all that we need to know for this body and life. So we need to listen. And we need to remember who God is and who we are in His presence. I know that many are making adjustments within their lives as a result of COVID-19, working at home, doing school at home. See a lot more people outside walking with their families, walking their dog. I've heard of a lot of people who are occupying their time by watching old videos or watching new video series or new television series or old television series, trying to occupy their time, trying to join together to make the best of a very difficult situation. But one of the activities that has caught my attention that people have been doing more frequently during this time is getting out the puzzle. Yes, the puzzle. Typically, our closets are full of puzzles. We may have done them once and then shelved them, or maybe haven't done them at all. But now is the time to get out those puzzles, to open the box and to dump all of the pieces on the table, and try to put everything together. To put everything together as it should be put together according to the cover of the box. And so what do you do? How do you approach putting things together? Do you look for the corner pieces first? Do you look for the pieces that have the edges on them, knowing that you can get the border done? Or do you start in the middle? Do you put all these pieces in one pile with a certain color, a certain image on them, so as to know that they're going to fit together eventually, so I'll keep these pieces together? How many of you that, when you've gone through putting together a puzzle, got rather frustrated at times? You can't find this certain piece. It doesn't quite fit together as you want it to fit. So what might you do? You might get the scissors out and cut some corners. Cut some pieces to fit where you want them to fit. Try to make it all work. Well, I'll cut this piece so it'll become a piece that can fit in the middle, or somehow mold and craft this piece, cut off some of the parts of it so it can become an edge piece or a corner piece. And by doing so, we think we're succeeding in actually finishing the puzzle, but what we will come to realize sooner or later, that even though we're fitting these pieces together and making it work, it doesn't make the image that the cover wanted us to make. It's not complete at all. It's not what it should be and what it needs to be. So today in our text, we're trying to put all of this calamity that's happened to Job together. And we're trying to put our lives that are filled with calamity and difficulty at times, even today with COVID-19, putting it all together. And so in order to put things together, we, like Job, cry out to God. God, what are you thinking? Tell me what I should know. Tell me what I should do. Help me to understand. God is listening to us. God knows everything about our lives, and he has promised to take care of us and to provide for us. But yet Job, and sometimes you and me, find God rather distant. I mean, what happens when we hear about a traumatic situation in our lives? Isn't there shock? Isn't there surprise? Could Job have expected what had taken place in his life already? No. Job was upright. He was considered a righteous man by God, blameless. Doesn't mean that he was perfect, but he certainly knew God, and God knew his faithfulness. And he was continuing on his life as he should, as he needed to do, and then everything came crashing down one by one. The shock of hearing that all of his livestock, all of his wealth is gone. The shock of hearing that his 10 children have died. The shock of looking at his own skin and seeing how it has been destroyed. He's not even a semblance of who he once was. You probably faced shock before, or are facing shock during this COVID-19. I don't know about you, but every day when I get the news from Wisconsin about the increasing numbers of those who are infected with COVID-19, or the increasing numbers of those who have died by it, I am shocked. Better safe at home? Hoping that that would be the answer, that the numbers would not increase, but decrease. Maybe it's the shock that you've had of getting that phone call that your loved one has died. Yeah, they may have been struggling with health, or maybe not, but it's still shocking when you hear the news. They're no longer with you. Or the shock of getting ready to go to work and getting that phone call saying, you're no longer employed. How can this be? Our company is doing fine. Doesn't make any sense. It doesn't add up. And so once we face the shock, what are we then next to do? There's a time of sorrow, isn't there? There should be a time of sorrow. I don't think we spend enough time in sorrow. Maybe because it's unpleasant. But we're dealing with something unpleasant. The death of a loved one, a disease, a loss of a job. It's important to sorrow and to grieve. To recognize we have real pain within us. That this really hurts. That's not something I can just sweep aside and just move on from. I must cry out. I must sorrow. Oftentimes when I get a call that one of our members has passed away, we talk about how it's very difficult to sorrow during this time. How immediately when a loved one dies, how things have to be planned out within 2 or 3 or 4 days. Running to the funeral home, running to church to plan a service, running to make pictures for poster boards, running to put forth videos, running to do this and that and get our affairs in order, and no time to have sorrow. No time to even think about what we're doing and why we're doing it. And our loved one has truly passed away, and that they are no longer to be with us. But as we think about Job and our lives in terms of the physical challenges that we face, the challenges of our body, we can't dismiss the sorrow that comes from our soul as well. During the season of Lent, we are called to repent of our sins, to recognize how we have sinned in our thoughts and our words and our deeds. To be, as Paul said, the good I want to do, that's not what I do. That's what I don't do. That's what I do. And how does Paul continue? Woe is me, a sinner. He is shocked. And we should be shocked as well. When we look at our lives and pledge to be faithful to God and we aren't, this shouldn't just be another day in our lives. It should be shocking how God is perfect and we are not. And that also then leads us to sorrow. Remember in our confession in our worship service, I confess that I'm a poor, miserable sinner. The sorrow is to be miserable. And our sin, its reality, should make us miserable. I can't believe what I have done. I can't believe this is taking place. And to think about how we've hurt God and hurt our neighbor, and truly think about the consequence that it has caused. For to sin against God and to sin against our neighbor brings the judgment of death upon ourselves. And here we are, in sorrow of our soul. But after we have our sorrow, putting things together, as Job is trying to do in his relationship to God, there is this struggle. The struggle that occurs because we have to continue to live. I often wonder whether Job went and visited where his children had died. If he went back to their house, as we often go back to grave sites to see where our loved one was laid, how we put flowers there, as we still struggle with the reality that they're gone. We struggle the fact that we used to be with them at Christmas and Easter, we used to celebrate birthdays, we used to have phone conversations. And now they're gone. And we struggle because no matter how another person can come into our lives or something else can come into our lives, no one can replace that void that we have. Job has an incredible void. His children, his wealth, his health, and those around him have said to curse God and die, have blamed him for the situation that is taking place. And sometimes we want to do the same. I've heard from actually quite a few people over this time of COVID-19 saying, what is God trying to tell us? What is God trying to tell us? And there's calling it a need for repentance. Maybe so. But when we look at COVID-19 and we look at Job's situation, have we done anything wrong? Have we actually committed a sin in order for this virus to exist? Did Job commit a sin for all of these things to take place? No. Job is living a life in God, facing what is the difficulties of being in a sinful world, and how God chooses to direct our lives. But as God chooses to direct our lives in the midst of this struggle, we know that God doesn't leave us or forsake us. He doesn't want anything in our lives that he allows to take place to pull us away from him. And so we may cry out to God, seeking his wisdom with our own wisdom, and say, why God? How God? I mean, Job said God was distant, that he had darkened his face from Job, that he was not there. We have been told to cast all of our anxieties on the Lord, for he cares upon us, to call upon him in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you. And that's what Job is looking for, and you and I look for as well. But I have good news for you. I have good news for me and for all people in God. God is not deaf to your cries. He is not foreign to what is taking place in your life. God is with you. God loves you, and he knows your struggle. He knows your hardship. He knows your sin. Not sin that causes these things within our world directly affecting us, but the reality of sin within our world and the need for having it be removed. And that's why God sent his son for you and me to struggle within this world. To struggle and not lose. To struggle to be victorious And that's what Jesus did on our behalf. He struggled with the devil. He struggled with the world. He fought against them with this message of forgiveness, life, and salvation. And he acted for us as we cannot act on our own. He did what the law required. He did everything necessary so that we could be saved. You see, in the midst of our struggle, in the midst of the struggle that Jesus faced, he kept his focus on the world, to redeem the world. And that meant he served us in the most wonderful of ways. He gave his life on the cross for you and me. He bore our sins in his flesh, God's complete wrath for sin upon his shoulders, that by his wounds, by his stripes, we are healed. Healed. Did you hear that? Healing. The healing of the soul, that sin-sick soul that is rebellious against God, that comes to the Lord in forgiveness and receives that forgiveness, that pardon and that peace, that restoration, that new health, that new life. And Jesus, who died for our sins, also rose again. He is the resurrection and the life. And because he has risen again, he declares to all who believe in him, there is paradise that awaits us all. We have a heavenly home in which all our struggles and all our pains and all our hardships and all our questions, they are no more. But rather we dwell in the presence of the one who has saved us, who has served us, and who has brought us into his heavenly kingdom. And dear friends, because of the service of Jesus in our lives, to forgive our sins, to restore our soul, going to that great length of love for us, he still loves us. Even in the midst of this situation, these hardships that we face, we can know that God serves us through his word that encourages us and grows our faith so that we stand firm in the foundation that is Jesus, to meditate upon his promises and to trust his word continually so we never lose hope. We never lose sight of the one who is always there with us. Some of the greatest impact that I have heard when it comes to those who are suffering and going through hardship, who have this sorrow, are the ones who use it to be a blessing unto others. I've heard members who get diagnosed with cancer and how they have great uncertainty going into the treatments, uncertainty going into what all of this means. And to have those who are going through cancer at that same time ministering to them, holding their hand, helping them to know what it's going to be like to receive those treatments, helping them to know what it is like to face the effects of the treatments, to know that they're not alone. Granted, that person who's already in the cancer treatments did not want to have to go through it to begin with. But now they're using it as an opportunity to be a blessing to those who are hurting. I see the same throughout this COVID-19 crisis. Even our own membership is asking those who are struggling with shopping to see if they can do it for them or if someone needs a ride. We know it's difficult to do at this time, but we are following the example of God who served us and his son Jesus to learn from our own difficulties how we can serve and love one another. I've also found that throughout this difficulty that people are actually communicating more through different means, through something like Zoom or through the way we are doing it today in our live stream. There are opportunities to keep in touch with those around us, to let them know that they're not alone. Job had a lot of questions. He was trying to put all the pieces of the puzzle together, and so do we as we go through our hardship, Just like putting together that puzzle that has 100 pieces on it or 1,000 pieces on it, and we're not sure how it quite goes. But God is with us. He sent His Son Jesus for you and me. And it is the cross, it is that cross for us that assures us of God's love and His peace and His help. That He is always for us. That He is always with us. Amen. And now may the love of God, which far surpasses our understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus until He does come again in glory. Amen. Once again, we aren't able to receive the offering as we aren't able to receive a lot that we would normally do in our worship service together, but we do offer the opportunity again to mail in your offerings, as many as you have done, to seek the electronic option or even simply giving. If you have any questions about this, please let us know. We're very thankful for all of the offerings and contributions that have already come in to continue to support this ministry. Continue to share the love that God has for us in Jesus. And let us pray. The resurrection to eternal life has come to the world in Christ Jesus. Let us pray for the deliverance of all who belong to Christ by faith and for all for whom He died and rose again. O God, as You created everything out of nothing by Your mighty word, so You have brought resurrection and eternal life to life by the mighty command of Your Son, Jesus, who went through death and emerged victorious over death. Help us to learn from Ezekiel's vision the death that comes when we lose faith and the life we gain through Your Spirit. Receive our praise and thanks for Your gift of eternal life. Help us to live as Your resurrection people, bringing the might of Your word to all. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As our Lenten season soon transitions to Holy Week, help us continue to recognize our sin, our need for repentance, and our dependence on our Savior. Help us to continually put to death those things of the flesh that lead us astray, that we be fed and led by Your life-giving Spirit. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We lift up those who mourn and carry grief and sorrow in the loss of loved ones, including Cindy Reinhold and her family at the death of her mother-in-law, Lorraine Reinhold, as well as Matt Serwan and his family at the death of his father, Matt, or at the death of his father. Help us to learn from our Savior at Lazarus' tomb that death is not the last word of this life, and that we rejoice in Your promises made, fulfilled, and yet to come of the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Enable and equip us to be heralds of the hope that is ours and witness to Christ and the power of His resurrection. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the sake of Your word, by which You cause repentance and faith to issue from human hearts, guide the leaders of nations and communities in our world to purpose ways of peace and tranquility among people, that Your word be preached for the salvation of all. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who are sick or infirm, disabled or troubled, especially David Cobbs, Hal Neitzel, Ron Habeck, as well as Bruce and Sue Kirk, who are traveling, and all those infected by the COVID-19 virus. Breathe Your life-giving Spirit into all in need, that hope, comfort, and peace in You may be theirs. Remind us that our ultimate healing is in the resurrection of the dead and the life everlasting. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
During this time of crisis, continue to help Your church through Your word, to rely on Your promise to always love and watch over us. As we lift up our members today, the Prills, Janet Schultz, and Richard Tim, may we continue in love for You and in love for one another. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And we continue in the responsive prayers within your bulletin. Dear Father, you have reconciled us to yourself through the bitter sufferings and death of Jesus.
You have taught us our need for Jesus, who is our mediator and Messiah,
our Redeemer and friend.
Let him rule as our King.
Guide us as our prophet.
And take away our sin as our High Priest.
Come that we may live in him and cleave to him in faith forever.
For we believe that
when you have tested us, we will come forth as gold. God of tender compassion, we believe that there is a plan.
A divine plan.
A plan where all things are working for our good.
And your glory.
And so we pray confidently in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And taught by our Lord and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray together.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
And now we listen to Luther's morning prayer as I pray. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings and life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul, and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. I have a couple of announcements. I'm going to do it from the lectern. Make sure I get those correct for you today. Our first announcement is to be reminded that we are going to continue to plan our services on a weekly basis. So be prepared for email weekly so that you can receive information about worship with the ongoing mandate from our state that pretty much everything is shut down and we are to be safe at home and we can't meet with over 10 people. We can plan on next Sunday as well, Palm Sunday, being our service here live streamed at 9:30 a.m. Also, here is a message from our church council. You also received this on Friday. The church council has made the decision to rescind the divine call made for a seminarian to fill the associate pastor position at Good Shepherd. This decision was not made easily, but only after much heart-searching discussion and prayer. First, we want to know that the call committee will remain active, an active committee, and we will continue to work to fill an associate pastor position, as was directed by the voters' meeting on November 3, 2019. However, we are postponing the call process contingent on a budget plan that provides ongoing support for the position. The postponement of the call process at this time was based on known financial concerns that could potentially be made worse by the introduction of COVID-19. Contributions thus far in 2020 have shown our ability to support the associate pastor position, have not shown our ability to support the associate pastor position. Considerable concern has been expressed about the congregation's lack of increased offerings to meet that obligation. We will work to develop a revised financial plan that will provide ongoing support for this position. The council asks for your patience, understanding, and prayers as we go forward during a time that is difficult for all of us. If you have further questions, please contact Steve Calder or Ryan Neumeyer. But I'm so happy that you joined us today. It's always great to be around God's Word, even though we're not present together in God's house, that you are supporting this ministry, that you are receiving God's Word, and we are assured that God has a plan for us, and His plan is always the best plan. So let's listen to our Lord and follow His direction, and always look to the cross and to the empty tomb that has brought our salvation through Jesus. Now we live with God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor, grant you his everlasting peace. Amen. And now we conclude with our closing hymn.